There's nobody tougher in Hollywood. There's just nobody tougher in Hollywood besides maybe The Rock, and well, yeah, and that and The Rock. But
there's
other
The Rock.
Than that,
there's Frank.
There's The Rock, and then there's Frank Grillo.
Yes.
And Frank
Mario Lopez.
Yep. Mario Lopez will give him. Mario Lopez will give you a run for him. I understand he knows his way around a boxing ring. He was a wrestler. So do me a favor. When you see Mario Lopez, and I, you know I love you,
mm-hmm.
yeah, and you're a tough guy. When you see Mario,
you're doing
me
a favor here, Frank.
You okay. shake his hand. You thank him for his work. You tell him that you tell him you're buying him his drink.
Can I stop you?
And you call him AC Slater.
You call him AC Slater. You,
I have
you,
no idea.
You go home. Hey, man.
Hey, bro.
Respect.
Hey, man.
No, I'm not saying that of disrespect.
Hey,
I'm sure
then you can
awesome.
Learn. Then you
bring,
can learn.
Bring Mario Lopez up with his shirt off right now.
Hey, you're going to learn when you're in the streets of Hollywood.
Yeah.
He's got, he catches you slipping.
He's got big hands, about your size, about 5'4", and you guys...
And can I say this?
What?
And I, with all due respect, Frank, might yeah. be better looking Frank.
Well, take
and
a
Frank's
look at
Frank's a dime piece.
Do me a favor and take a look at what he's working with.
Jesus Christ.
Pretty thin there.
Now you want to watch your
Frank's
P's and
not,
Q's,
Frank's
Frank?
Frank's not that... Whoa, he's got his hands wrapped, dude. He's got... You guys are the same guy. You guys are the same guy. You know there's zero difference between you and Mario Lopez.
How old is Mario?
Old enough, dude. Old enough to administer an ass whooping. Okay.
You know, he has an all boxing podcast.
43.
The guy can box.
How old are you, Frank?
51. 53.
Got to give Frank the edge. Got to give Frank the edge.
Really?
Yeah.
Por qué?
Well, Frank's 51.
He's got veins in his head. He could have an aneurysm at any time.
I see Frank training.
I see
Matter
the
of fact, he's overtrained. We had a conversation this morning.
I am overtrained.
You're like Chael Sonnen. You're overtrained right now.
Well,
who's that?
He just doesn't know anyone.
You son of a
bitch. That would be so funny.
Well, you know, Frank is coming off of about a week of doing stunt fighting with the great Matt Hughes.
The
and
great
you
Matt
called
Hughes.
Me and told me that it's literally a different kind of strength.
The
it's a gorilla
Matt
strength.
How
actually,
nice
I talked
he?
To – he's the fucking nicest guy ever. I mean, we became fast friends, and we had I've had probably the best time with this guy than I have had on the show in 3-4 years.
Really?
So yeah. He was on the set of Kingdom. And what was he doing on there?
So Alvy, my character, comes out of retirement like Hoyce Gracie to do a one-off,
for
like
sure.
a Legends fight.
Yeah, too.
And he comes out as mm-hmm. Matt Hughes.
Oh, wow.
So we trained for 2 weeks doing the choreography and stuff and just kind of getting physical and being used to each other.
Hey, bro.
You broke your hand.
No, hold on. Are you the one that convinced Matt Hughes to actually do this in real life? Like, did he read the script and go, that's brilliant?
No.
And then after he left training with your ass, he announces, I want to take a fight in UFC.
He was thinking about that all along. But I'll tell you, after we were done shooting, he was exhausted. He called me. He emailed me from his farm. He goes, I'm busted up. He goes, I'm exhausted.
It's work. Yeah, it's work,
you.
Son. Yeah,
you got to do it over and over again.
Yeah.
Every guy in Warrior got injured. Like every stuntman, every actor, at one point at least twisted a knee or did something.
I'll tell you, the only thing that really happened to me was my hands are broken up because we're in those 4-ounce gloves. But we only did it once or twice because we were so down with it. And it was less about the choreography and more about us kind of just improvising and hitting each other.
Yeah.
And so it was fun. I mean, he was slamming me to the canvas.
You guys would train every day.
Every day, yeah.
Tell him what you did to. Tell him what you did to everybody. You and Matt.
So, So we're in an arena with like 1,000 extras, and we had planned this for a week. I said, because at one point he had me down against the cage, and he was just pounding me until the bell rang. I said, keep hitting me after the bell rings, and then I'm going to jump up, and I'm going to push you. And I'm going to say some words, and you're going to come at me, and it's like we're going to fight. I'm going to run out of the cage like really angry into the hall, right, and freak everybody out. So we do it, and I'm telling you, if I didn't have my hand up, he would have knocked me out. Because
you can still feel it.
And let me tell you, Matt Hughes does not know how to pull punches. He wants to fight.
He's a farm boy.
He wants to fight.
Yeah.
He'll fight a girl. I mean, he'll fight anybody.
Yeah.
And aside from him, probably the strongest guy I've ever encountered in my life.
I mean,
really. So he does the whole thing. He pounds me for like 12 seconds, lumps me up a bit. I jump up. Juan Archuleta gets in the middle of us.
He doesn't know that you guys
I push.
He doesn't know you guys are actually.
Not yet. Yeah. I push Juan Archuleta into Matt Hughes. And everybody goes, they think it's the part of the show. The director and the head of DirecTV was there. They freak out. They think this guy's going to kill me.
Because you're going, what the
I go, come on. I go, come on, motherfucker. You know what you did. I'm pointing at him saying, you know what you did. Come on, motherfucker. I'm not afraid. Come on. And then I'm standing there. He's going, what? I go, all right, tough guy, let's go outside. So I run outside thinking he's going to follow me. The camera follows me to the hallway. Now all extras are standing up. DirecTV is called, doesn't know what's going to happen. Like, am I stupid enough to come back in and fight Matt Hughes? I turn around to the camera. I go, get the fuck out of my way. I run. I beeline into the cage. I go, come on, motherfucker. Like, well, you know what you did. Let's go. Let's go. So he comes at me. And right before we were about to hit each other, we hug each other.
Started laughing. Like, ah! That team is going, ah!
They were shitting themselves.
I bet, man.
Of course. Yeah. You know, you don't want to get in the way of that. Matt, don't. Stop.
Yeah,
Matt.
Yeah, man.
You know Matt has a twin brother.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, man.
Yes, he does.
Just as strong.
Identical.
Just as
strong. Brother.
Just as crazy.
Jeff was a great wrestler, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Those two brothers.
He's just basic and strong. I mean, he is just...
Says grace.
He's a legend, man.
Says grace before every meal. He's a beautiful guy.
He's a beautiful guy. At the end of it all, you know, not to get hokey, but he came in my trailer. We were down, you know, on location. He came and he goes, man, I had the best time. He goes, you made this so great. He goes, I said, you know what, dude? I'm in my 50s. I don't make friends. I said, I think we're friends. I think we made friends.
I'm getting all full of friends. Yeah. You know what? I think it just occurred to me, I got a spot for my friends.
I'm in my 50s. I don't make friends. So John Stamos, I'm doing this movie, and he's on the phone. And he's like, yeah, okay, sure. Uh-huh, I guess. Okay. Yes. Okay, then.
Hangs, by the way, love that
and
guy.
I go, what happened? He goes, this guy wants to be my friend. I'm 50. I have too many friends. If you're the only way you're going to be my friend is if you have a private jet and you can fly me places. It's so fucking great.
Yeah.
You're kind of all set on
You're
friends.
All set on
friends. You're not 34. 100%.
You're done.
Like, my kid, my girl wanted to take him to this birthday party. And she's like, come on. What you call it? Husband's going to be there. I'm like, I don't know him. She's like, you can make a friend. I'm
like, making friends.
Hey, man, I am all set. I'm pretty sure we're not in the same thing.
Yeah, I'm good.
My parking lot's all full of friends.
I know.
It's like, there are no.
You know what it's like? When you get to our age, it's like you've got a closet overflowing with clothes. It's like the last thing I need is another pair of pants. You want to need anymore? Yeah. I'm getting rid of shit. I'm down.
I'm sure there's great pants.
Yeah.
But I'm good with these.
I'm good.
And they're pretty good. They're
I don't
pretty
see
good.
My real friends enough. You know what I mean?
I hear you.
It's funny.
It's funny as shit. Yeah.
But it was great. It was epic. It's going to be the best fight of the show by far.
Just Kingdom is the best show that I think is out there that nobody, not enough people get to
not
see.
Not enough people get
it
to see.
It drives me crazy.
What other MMA guys have you had on?
Oh, we've had Cub, and we've had
Daddy Stevenson.
Joe Daddy Stevenson's on the show. So is Juan Archuleta. We've had a bunch. We've had all kinds of people. Mm. I can't even remember, you know, half the time.
Tons
but
of
they
guys.
Come through just to hang out. Lyoto Machida, you know, came through. They just kind of hang out with us, and they like to see what it's about. They love the show. I mean, any gym I go to, people freak out.
That's, you know, cool,
man. They love the representation of the world.
You're taking this one step further, and you're doing a show. We can't say what it's on, but you're doing some. I mean, obviously on Kingdom, it's acting, but you're taking it to the 10th degree with your new kind of project.
Yeah, I got something.
Can you talk about that?
I can. I won't say where it's going to be shown because that's going to be an announcement, and that's all the fun stuff. But basically, you know, I've been traveling around the world the last few years, and everywhere I go, whether it's China or Brazil or, you know, even France, I mean, I find a gym, whether it's a boxing gym or a Muay Thai gym. And we went to Thailand and we did Muay Thai for 3 weeks, and I become part of the culture through fighting. So I learn about religion. I learn about food. I learn about just the anthropology of the place because of through these fighters, you know? And there's
because it's intimate, right?
Because it's a brotherhood. I mean, it's a brotherhood. It's a sisterhood. You know,
you speak the same language wherever, whatever country you're in.
You really do. Fighting's fighting. You really do. Fighting is fighting. And although I'm not a professional fighter, nor have I ever been a professional fighter, I love it. I mean, I love combat sports. And I just found that it's kind of like an Anthony Bourdain show, like the travel, the No Reservations, where he goes around and he has food in every country.
And through food, you learn.
You learn. But now this is, I'm going to Dagestan, I'm going to Chechnya, I'm going to Afghanistan, I'm going to Senegal.
All safe places.
All really, really safe
But you do
places.
Have, and if not to be too detailed, but I know you have certain high-level special forces, a team of guys.
Team of guys. I also have Greg Jackson, who works as our technical advisor on Kingdom. He's coming with me. He also does a lot of work with special ops guys, CIA guys that know those areas really well, know if, God forbid, there was a problem, how to extract. You know, it's less about shooting your way out. It's more about
finesse.
Extraction.
And knowing who to talk to. And who, you know, apparently, like, a lot of those places that are tribal, like Afghanistan, if you know the warlord that controls that area, and right. you get the okay, it's like the mafia.
It is like the mafia.
Sure, and that's Tark exactly could help with that.
Yeah,
yeah. Well, we're already
Tark met. Yeah. He met Tark. They were like boyfriend at my party.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. So in any event, so I embed myself in whatever the fight culture is. In most of the cases, I will at the end of it do something, whether it is a fight or an exhibition or something. So I'll be embedded in what they're doing. So unlike Bourdain, who just kind of watches them make food and then eats it, basically I go in there and do the thing with them to connect. So I can connect with them even a little bit deeper and really kind of learn about the place, the people. These are places where, especially in America, we have a very specific idea about. And, hopefully, through that you learn that people are just people. We all want the same thing. We all want our kids mm-hmm. to be safe and we want to be happy. And
maybe you guys have looked into it, I don't know. Have you ever thought about going, and maybe it is on the radar, into Russia with wrestling or boxing?
Yeah, we have.
Have you been on like a traditional Russian mat?
I have not, but I know it is on the list.
You have, Brendan?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What is, when you say traditional Russian mat, explain that.
When I was in Montreal with George St. Pierre, he would wrestle with this Russian team. And I went in and George was like, listen, man, don't talk unless you're spoken to. Stay on the mat until they invite you to participate. Wow. And these are all, national team members, like just monsters. And it's me and Nate Marquardt. And we're like, what the? And he's like, and make sure as soon as you walk into the mat, you go directly to the head coach and just thank him for giving you the opportunity to watch the practice or participate.
Wow!
I'm like, what the?
Almost like a traditional Asian.
And it was all quiet, and guys just doing work. Just there's these huge mats, and there's probably, I don't know, 15 matches going on at the same time. But you can't just be like, oh, I'm next. Like there's a heavyweight, I'm next. You have to wait till they go, you're up.
Wow.
You're up. Yeah, and then you have to wrestle certain way. Like
Greco or something. Or?
Well, no, it's freestyle wrestling, but you can't. There's no stalling. Like you better
right.
go, man.
Right.
Huh. I just remember waiting there, like. 30, 40 minutes go by. I'm like, any day now. And George is like, wait, man, you gotta earn your place here. Wait. And I'm like, oh my God.
And you were there.
Very traditional.
You were there to learn, obviously.
I was there with George. Guys. George was doing that as part of his camp. Mm-hmm. He'd go there 2-3 times a week. They knew George. Even George, he was like, at first, it was tough, man. Some days I didn't get any matches. Some days I got one.
Wow.
But he's been going there for years.
Humble guy.
And just because we were with George, we got in. But, at the time, I think I was ranked 12th in the world. And Nate was, I don't know, 8. And if we weren't with George, we wouldn't have got in.
Right.
But it was just such a different culture. I just remember being like, I wasn't scared or I wasn't offended. I was like, this is so cool, man.
Right.
Like, it was such an honor to be part of this.
Right.
And I was terrified because his son was the heavyweight and he's such a monster.
Yeah.
Didn't wrestle me.
He didn't wrestle
no.
you.
No. He was like, what?
How did you fare with those guys? Because you were playing their game. It must have been quite the challenge.
It's quite the challenge. I was more impressed with George. He went toe to toe with their top guy. This black guy, I think his name was Cleto or something like that. And they were just, I mean, it was a match.
Part of Russia.
I mean, the Canadians wanted him on their Olympic team.
Yeah, that was the first time. Like, there's MMA wrestling, and George is the best at it,
right?
Because he took down Koscheck,
right.
who's a beast, stud.
Yeah.
And then, so you see it, but with the jab, just worry about the striking, his timing. He put right. it all together. That's why he's the best.
Right.
But then when I saw him actually do straight up freestyle wrestling, I'm like, oh my God, that motherfucker can wrestle. Yeah,
yeah. And he's a great athlete.
Jesus.
I mean, I was just watching him warm up down at Jackson's. I was like, I mean, his vertical jump was, I mean, he was like up in the air like Michael Jordan.
He came out of the locker room. This motherfucker, he had a singlet on. I was like, all right, well, that's a little extreme. But, all right.
Yeah.
Nice body.
Let's relax a little bit,
yep.
though, huh?
Yep.
Not a wrestler, So, had a singlet on.
Singlet. You wear the uniform when you get in there.
No, we didn't.
I have a singlet on. Underneath. I've never taken my singlet off from since high school. I wear the same one from high school, so it's very tight.
Did you wear the leggings with the singlet or just
sure
the
didn't, buddy.
sure didn't, buddy.
Actually, remember those? It would depend, but I would wear knee pads because I didn't want my knees.
Oh, no, you just like the look.
I think Rush would be a cool one. There's parts
Rush
of,
is on the list.
I'm sure Brazil's on the list. There's parts of Brazil.
We're trying to get, we're going to,
you spent time in Brazil. You trained with, a lot of people don't know, you trained with Hicks and Gracie for years, right?
Yeah, yeah. And we were going to Brazil. We're talking to Cron Gracie. To Cron Gracie to come down with us. Because we like to take somebody who's, it'd be great to have you come with one of these places.
I'm down to do one, man.
Yeah.
I'm down to do one.
I know you're stacked.
The thing with Brazil, I remember training when I was getting ready for Nogueira. No Brazilians opened their doors to me. Zero. I went down there for the press conference, and I wanted to just train gi nonstop to get ready for Nogueira. And only one gym did. This guy named Gordo, who used to train and work with Nogueira. He opened his door. Now, he was cool about it. The rest of his school was not.
Right.
And I watched, you were American, and
I'm fighting Nogueira. Okay. And if the entire,
so nobody opened
the entire nation knew. No, they're like, fuck. You, wow. Gringo.
Right.
But this guy opened his gym, and he's a legend down there. You look him up, Gordo. He cornered Rafael Dos Anjos for years. Big gym, man. Big time guy out there. And so I walk in. I'm a little nervous. I have Klopp with me. I have my team with me, Lex. I have everyone. And I remember him being so cool, like, yeah, you have to wear a gi, though, right? And I was like, I do train gi, but that's not, like, my forte. And he's like, yeah, you got to put a gi on if you're going to be in this gym. Wow. So I'm like, all right, cool. Put this gi on. If you guys know anything, like if you train with gi, the bagger they are, the worse it is.
Yeah.
This gi was made for a Kodiak grizzly bear, maybe. They literally
so
gave me
pillowing cloth.
So already I'm like, all right. Right. Pillowing, all right. Yeah, I see what's going on here.
Right.
And then like, oh, we don't have any brown belts either, so here's a white belt. All right. So you just check your ego. I'm glad to be there.
Sure.
And he goes, all right, so what we're going to do is I'm going to line up the guys for you. And they just threw me through the ringer.
Oh, boy. Yeah, yeah,
the
yeah.
Ringer. Oh, boy. But it was just cool, the different personalities. And then once they realized, like, I wasn't a punk and I was there just to learn and, like, and do work and just kind of embrace myself in their culture, they took me on – this would be great. They took me on this hike behind there that was – the hardest thing in my life.
Right.
Oh, and they go, dude, it's going to take you about 4 hours to get up there. You have to get down before nightfall.
Right.
Otherwise, bad things happen.
Bandits.
I go,
bandits.
What's bad things?
Jaguars.
Just get down before
Banditos
nightfall.
Banditos and jaguars.
So we're going. This guy's in a Sunga. Power ass. Cock hanging out the front. Barely.
Good man.
Powering up this mountain. Barefoot, right? What? And I'm like, what the fuck? We're trying to keep up with him. My manager, Lex, is flagging behind. And he goes, we have to leave him behind. And I go, well, no Marine left behind. He goes, you a Marine? And no, he goes, we got to get going. We leave him. We go up. We come down. We don't see Lex the next morning. Lex, like, found some hut and slept there for the night because he's so scared to get down the mountain.
Oh, my Random God. Shit.
But anyways, that was part of, like, that. It was the funnest time, one of the funnest times of my life. I don't think, I've never talked about
You've
this.
You've never talked about it. I'm like, this is one of the best stories. Are you fucking out of your mind? What a
so
great story.
So he climbs me up there, and we're literally, like, there's a flat part of the rock, and he's like, you just got to climb up. And I'm like, dude, we are so high up. I'm like, if I slip, I'm going to die, man. And he goes, don't slip.
God, that macho great. Shit's crazy.
Ask Klopp about it. Klopp was with me.
Fuck.
Klopp was with me. And then
Klopp's not built for rock climbing.
No. Then we get done, and we have the best food ever. It's this village that's on, like, this little island that we take this skimpy boat to that's filling up with water because our fat asses are in it, like the bomb's filling with water. And it's the best food ever, man.
Right.
And then we have to take a shower. There's no hot water, man. You only take cold showers. And then they go, this is how you stay healthy.
That's right.
And the riots was good
warriors,
for you.
And by the way, that's what I'm talking about with this show, which I'm really excited to go and do.
It's a brilliant idea, man.
Once you earn their respect, I was in Thailand over the summer. I was doing a movie. My family met me in Thailand. And me and my oldest son, we joined this Muay Thai camp for 2 weeks, Lin Muay Thai Camp, which is a famous place off Phuket. And you know, the first 3 days, they're like, they're feeling you out. They're trying to figure out who you are and why you're there. After you show up every day and you're taking punches and kicks and, you know, you're still there, all of a sudden they start to smile.
Mm-hmm.
It starts that with a smile. Mm-hmm. And then there's like a joke. And and before you know it, I'm having lunch with them.
You're embraced with them. And you're not there to take advantage of them.
I want to get a tattoo. They get their tattoo artist to come down to meet me
That's
to talk
so cool,
to
man.
I mean, it becomes like, and there's nothing you can't talk to them.
And you know what's interesting is, like, there's all those spots all over the world. And we can talk about Japan and China. It's brilliant. Australia, New Zealand. There's so many cool spots. But I think there's a spot that people overlook, and it's here in America, in New York. Brownsville, New York.
Right.
You go there.
Brooklyn?
Yes. There's a culture there with boxers for whatever reason.
So Brownsville, just a little background. I don't know if you know this, where Mike Tyson comes from, but it was also always traditionally a very, very dangerous part.
I know.
And Larry King came from there, in fact, as well.
Oh, there's more. Yeah.
There's so
more.
Many boxers.
Jacobs comes from there. You look at the amount of just studs that come from there. Mm, yeah. And there's a gym there. And I think if you just dove into that culture, all black culture, and they're, you know, they're paying their dues, man, I think that could be cool. Wow.
I mean, it's all over the world. Like there's
yeah,
there's
but
crazy,
people always think I have to go. China.
No, whoa. No,
there's some
not.
Shit here. Huh. Yeah. You spend some time at Jackson's Albuquerque, and you get to run the hills and Arlovsky's.
I did those hills. Hill of Tears. Yeah.
There's Cerrone there.
Oh, dude, I was with George. It was Keith Jardine. It was Joe Daddy was fighting at the time. There was so many guys. Guys puking. I mean, it's amazing.
It's like nothing you've ever seen. Yeah. In New York, you go to Phil Nurse's gym. Phil Nurse is the guy that started the Superman punch.
I was there in the gym. We were training for Warrior when Phil Nurse came down and met George St. Pierre and taught him the Superman jab.
That's where it came from. So Phil Nurse used to be a badass fighter, and he used to throw the Superman punch.
Yep.
He taught George that punch. Wow. That's how it got famous.
I watched
then
him.
Then he
do
taught
that.
John Jones all that stuff.
Yep. Phil Nurse is a little guy. He's got a gym in New York City on the east
have
side.
Have you been to his gym?
Yeah.
It's the most beautiful gym you've ever seen in the world. I don't know what his fucking
it's an MMA gym or is it a kickboxing?
No, it's a straight kickboxing.
Wow.
Wood flooring. You walk in, you're like,
gorgeous.
What the
yeah.
Wow.
But there's those gems, these guys here, man. And
yep.
It's crazy.
Huh. You don't Phil Nurse? You never
I don't. I don't. And I but I love
he
I
was
love
our he was
it.
Our coach on the one of our coaches on the Ultimate Fighter. That's where I met him. Rashad brought him in.
Right.
Rashad was our coach. Mm. And just the stuff you teach heavyweights. And
yeah.
We're like, oh my God.
What did he fight at? Lightweight?
He's little. Stud. You watch his videos and we didn't know who he was. We didn't at the time. We know he was working with George and that's how he was introduced to us. Like, Superman Punch, this is the guy. Mm-hmm. We're like, well, we're heavyweights.
I watched the mechanics go down. Like, I watched Phil.
He's brilliant, man.
The mechanics, and George would watch and he'd do it. And then he watched, and he do it, and then he jumped into spar, and he did it.
He could do it.
I mean, the guy was amazing.
He can freak out. Are you going to go to Dagestan where Khabib Nurmagomedov trains? Is that where you're
going?
Yeah,
I'm going with a guest of his. Yeah, which is kind of interesting.
So cool. You know, it's funny because the Soviets and that area in back in the day when they were competing with the United States, so that you know they were the first guys to put somebody in space, and we were having all these competitions with them as an arms race. And the Soviets decided that the way to show the world that they had a lot of power was to beat America at the strength sports. So they poured their resources into powerlifting, Olympic lifting, I should say, into boxing, into wrestling. And so you have this tradition. By the way, that area was always a very hard place to get
tough.
By. Always tough people. The Chechens,
that weather make tough.
Correct. But they really put a concerted effort into competing and getting high-level you know, wrestling, sambo, and all that stuff.
Jackson's out there a lot. Like, Jackson knows them. He's coming with us there for that reason. I mean,
and
he knows
he's
going
to be so good for you guys. Because if you can just dive in that culture, because the Russians, man, like, you know, Arlovsky's from, I think, Bulgaria. Is this
Arlovsky, I believe, is from Ukraine.
He's not from Ukraine. I think it's Bulgaria, isn't it?
I don't think so. I think I believe he's from Russia, and
Belarus.
He's from Belarus. Okay,
right.
Belarus.
Sorry, he's from Belarus.
Which was a Soviet
Republic.
When
I first met him, I was like, he fucking hates me. I've been watching this
guy. Doesn't smile, right?
We're going to be training partners. This guy fucking hates me. Mm. And I came in, I drink coffee all the time, and I didn't know him, and he was very, like, cold as fuck, man. I'm like, dude, I'm here for 6 weeks. We're the only heavyweights. Let's be cool. And we're going, and I go, sorry, man, my breath smells like coffee. And he goes, better than yesterday. Was shit yesterday. And I was like, but that was his way of joking.
Right.
Like, I didn't know. We don't.
Right.
Because
there's no tone.
Those people
you're making a good point here, though, because I think to get along in a fight gym, which is a very intimate thing, you have got to be culturally sensitive. You've got to understand what the culture is about. Russia.
Exactly.
So in Russia, they'll always talk about this. To just smile in Russia, is considered look like a dumbass.
Yeah.
Well, because it would be, you don't see Russians when they meet each other. You don't just smile or walk down the street smiling.
No.
That is very un-Russian because it's considered essentially like you're a fool. So your smiling is reserved for very special occasions.
There's also just serious dudes, too.
Yeah.
Like serious.
I asked Greg,
I went, I don't know what I did to Andre, man. I don't get why he hates me. He goes, oh, he loves you. No, he's just telling me how he's loving working with you. I'm like, what the fuck is wrong with them?
Because Americans.
Like,
by the way, it's as simple as we think people who are waiters and waitresses in Paris are nasty because they don't engage. Yeah. It's just not their culture.
First of all, it's their career.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
They're professional. Yeah, when you're in Paris, you're not an actor. You're a wine waiter. You're a waiter.
Right.
You know,
right. But that's their culture. Their culture is to do what they do, and it's not to engage with you. This country is very different than most
other countries. Country has an interesting, a difference, and it's to our strength, but also there's a price, with everything, strength and weakness. In the United States, anybody's doing anything. We are pioneers in our nature. Anybody's doing anything is on their way somewhere. Okay. So if you see a waiter, if you see a lawyer, everybody is on their way. It's a stop. Whereas in Europe and in a lot of the parts of the world, because people weren't really afforded that luxury, because you don't think that way, this is what I do. Well, and this is what I will do. And this is what I am.
And because
so the idea that I'm steaming out of my position doesn't exist.
Yeah. You're socialists or communists and this is what you do.
Yeah. Or that's my job. And this is what my father
did.
And
they're content with it.
That's right.
That's the big thing. That's the big thing.
With us, there's self-shame. Oh. Like if you're a waiter, shit, man, I'm like, I'll have the orange chicken and they think, this isn't my full-time job.
There you go.
I'll just take the hot and sour soup. I get that. Listen, here's a script. You're like, God,
look at you and I. At 50 years old, the things couldn't be going better. My wife's got to sit there and go, you're not present. Why? Because I'm thinking about what else I'm going to do. You're the same way. You're the same way. We're never, we suffer from that American disease.
But you do, because time slips away.
Fuck
but you
yeah,
do
you,
need, you do need to kind of be aware of everything every day.
Yes.
Like I know it's cliche tough, right? to say, but you have to stay present.
Talk about this because you are somebody who really found you've always been working as an actor, but you and I have known each other over 20 years now.
Yeah.
And been close as it gets, but you found success on a high level. You just did this movie Wheelman. I can't wait for people to see this fucking movie. But you have found success and for people who don't know, at probably the age of 48.
A little earlier, but okay, probably about 44.
44?
Yeah.
When was Warrior? Because after Warrior, things started really kicking.
44. But you know, it's funny because from the time I've been 28 years old, I never stopped working as an actor.
Yes.
Never stopped supporting myself. I was on a soap opera. I was on sitcoms.
Right.
Never for a long time. That's the problem. You know, you think, oh, this is the big break. Everybody's going to know me. My life's easy. It's easy. It's great. But that's not the way it is. It wasn't my trajectory. And, you know, I've always been kind of famous to like a small group of people. Mm. To get notoriety for something you do worldwide is
Captain America.
But when you think about guys like Clooney and George and Pitt and guys like Tom Cruise who are that is such a crazy thing. Like for like young actors and to think that is the wrong thing to shoot for. I mean, it's such the wrong thing to shoot
for. It's unrealistic, isn't it?
It's so unrealistic. It's so unhealthy and it's very unattainable.
Because some would say you're making, when you said from 24 to 44, you're working, that'd be making
I make
it.
Millions of dollars.
That would be making. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? That's making it.
Yeah, but that's making it. I've had many TV series. I've done 15 pilots.
Yes.
I mean, never stop working. Have a great life.
Always worried, though.
Always worried, but you're still not, you know, I'm not a household name. I mean, probably more kids know me than adults. You know, I don't. So it's a very interesting.
Well, now you're producing movies and now you have a production company.
Yeah, and now I'm in
huge movie.
I'm in control of my own kind of thing. I have a part in Joe Carnahan, who you guys know is my partner. And, you know, we're about to go do a couple movies. The Raid. We got The Raid that we're remaking.
You're doing a lot of stuff in China, right?
I did a movie last year in China, which is called Wolf Warrior 2, which is a big Chinese kind of
Tell us about that. Will you ever do a movie again in China?
I can't say
never
no.
Never say never.
I can't say no, but, you know, it was a tough 2.5 months in
Why
Beijing.
Why is that?
Again, culturally, it is so different.
Like food-wise?
Food-wise, I couldn't eat. I lost a lot of weight because I was on the outskirts of Beijing. And at times, I literally was eating almonds every day for breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Jesus,
all I could trust. And it's a very, you know, it's an entirely different culture, race, religion. I mean, when you go to Beijing, then it's like Beverly Hills a little bit. But outside of there, you know, technology has eliminated a lot of jobs in countries like that. And so you see a lot of people with nothing to do. You see a lot of cities that are empty. Like they just build cities. But there's nobody there.
Ghost cities for real. There's nobody there.
There's nobody there.
Was the pollution bad?
I couldn't breathe. And then every day they'd fly their fighter jets around the city. Every morning, they circle around. They weren't doing maneuvers, just to let everybody know they had planes. Like, it was really interesting. They'd literally just go in circles.
And how about the stuntmen? Are they, there's a real union? They're very safe with the stuntmen?
There's no unions. There's no length of time that you can or can't work. Some of these guys would work literally
That's why Apple opened up their son.
Round the clock.
I see why you went there.
Oh, my God. They exploit. I mean, I don't think they have the same... They just don't. They don't have the same values of you know.
Well, they're starting. Well, I mean, the thing about China now is, was hilarious is that because there is such a huge growing middle class and an upper class.
Yeah.
That now to do business there with your factories, you're paying, and they should. You're paying wages that are they're demanding much higher wages. They're demanding a lot of things which they should.
And they
as
should.
They become much more wealthier. So now what they're doing is companies are now outsourcing. They're going, China's too expensive. Go to Vietnam. Go to Malaysia.
That's right. Damn it.
They're losing.
That's
they're losing jobs for real. The Chinese are going.
You're right.
The
middle class is growing. The second and third tier cities in China. I think they were putting up a movie theater every like 3 minutes. Like. That's how fast those cities are growing. Yeah. You know, these
and
people are
to live in them.
Movies
workers.
Kill it over there.
Movies kill it.
I heard someone say in the business, they went, yeah, it's not going to do good here. We didn't make it for here. It's going to kill
in
over
China.
China.
And only 34 movies, that's only right. 34 foreign movies are allowed into China every year. So Captain America being one of the 34. And they have very strict regulations about what films can or can't qualify.
Why is
that's
that?
Why it's just the government. That's why you'll see a lot of movies are co-productions between China and another country.
Yes.
Because then it's easier to get your film into China, is probably, as we speak, becoming the biggest film market in the world.
Well,
because
you know if you get into China, how many people are going to view it?
Oh, my God.
Especially if they don't allow 34?
Yeah. But twice a year, I think August is the month because it's the new year, the film I'm doing, I did, Wolf Warrior, is the only film coming out.
Damn.
So they really regulate.
So you're Tom Cruise in China?
No, I'm not.
Tom Cruise.
You worked with Tom Cruise.
Barely. It's Captain America so big there that even a secondary character like me.
Killing it.
Yeah.
I love it. That's they were so doing cool, this thing. Man. I was reading this thing about Japan, and they're really protectionist about movies and everything else. they're having a major problem. Japan's economy grew at 1% last year.
Yeah.
And you'd be amazed at why, but I'll get that in a second. They were talking about, they had, I think, 300,000 asylum seekers, you know, and refugee status and stuff like that. Japan allowed in how many?
Zero.
None.
28. Yeah. 28. They're a country of 170 million almost now, I think, or something crazy. And they, of the 170 million, 2 million at the most are immigrants, most of whom are on temporary status. So what they're finding is that because of the economy and a lot of other things, they don't have like literally enough young people to support their old people. So they're having a major, major problem. Their economy is growing very slowly. You've got all these old people, middle-aged people, who need to be supported by the younger people.
Right.
At one point, I think only 10% of Japan are going to be babies in the next couple of years.
And to know the Japanese culture, it's very important in the Japanese culture to take care of.
Yeah, correct. That's everything, right? Yeah.
Correct. And so what now in Japan, as we're talking about anti-immigration here, in Japan... The conversation is, you guys basically have to have immigration. You've got to figure out a way to get over your ethnocentrism.
Right.
The idea that anybody is different is, you know, if they don't bring in not only immigrants, but young immigrants who are having babies, they are not going to be, their economy is in serious fucking trouble. And it was for a while, Japan was the country that was going to take over the world.
I have some big white boy friends that love Japanese.
There you go. Let's get some.
Get them down there.
I think.
I'm going there
with the show.
Oh, you are?
And I think Rampage is going to come with me because he's really popular in Japan.
Oh, yeah. I ever tell you
he
about,
only likes.
Tell you about when Rogan got up and there were all these like Chinese. He didn't know if they're Chinese or Japanese, and they were just in the room. It was at the Comedy Store. It was really dark, and he gets up and he goes, "Man, a lot of Chinese. I think there are a lot of Chinese people, great people. But I'll tell you what, you people need black cock in your gene pool. Let's get some black guys in China and do some fucking because I am tired."
Dude.
I was laughing.
Were
I was
they
like,
laughing?
Ooh! The whole place was like, I don't know. I was like,
that's so funny.
Let me tell you, it is wild being in China because everyone's Chinese. I mean, it's
you're the outlier.
You get a sense.
I went there when it was communist. I went there in 1985 when everybody was in blue uniforms.
Right.
Did you stick out, Frank? Like, were you bigger than everyone? Like, are you?
No, I'm not. Listen, I'm never bigger than anyone. And by the way, in Beijing, there's some big people. But
Chin's Korean. He's fucking enormous.
Because he's a milk
drinker. Northern Chinese, I think, are the bigger ones. They're
Mongolian.
They're big people. Yeah, big, athletic, strong. They're great. Listen, they're great people. It's just a different
culture.
It's just
hard for you to
feel. Yeah, they're really great people. Anyway, that's kind of where this
cool,
idea
man.
Was. I sprung was because I trained
yeah,
there
you're in all these different.
I
places.
Trained at Fight Republic gym in China. We became such good friends with this guy Gil Choi, who owns the place. Wound up going to these really cool clubs with him. These supper clubs and stuff. Just became pals with his son, and I'm like, there's something to be said for
yeah.
this. I come to China. I don't speak this language. Here I am.
Makes you feel good.
Yeah, it really does.
Makes you feel like there's nice people.
Yeah, now watch me get my head chopped off and fucking
yeah, yeah. You hear what happened to Frank in Tajikistan?
Yeah.
What? Yeah, they cut his face off.
In Chechnya, the one thing I've noticed is that the president of Chechnya, who is Putin basically put him in there.
Right.
His father was assassinated by the Checheny.
Yeah. By the way, the guys that hang around with that guy are bigger than him.
Oh, yeah. No, they're no joke. Those guys are... The Chechenis, first of all, have always been very big people. They're like the Samoans of the mountains.
Are they?
Oh, yeah. The Chechenis are all giant men. They're known for being barrel-chested, big, powerful people.
Right.
And
I just got excited.
And, yeah. and in fact, the president, there's a video of the president, and you see him... It's fucking crazy. We should actually bring it up. He's you see him kind of getting low. He's a big bear of a man and accused of human rights things. He's not exactly Mother Teresa. And he's getting low, obsessed with MMA. And you see him stalking, and all of a sudden you see him jump in the water and grab onto a giant crocodile. And he picks up this giant caiman in a bear hug, and he caught apparently what looks like a wild caiman.
Not in Russia.
I don't know where it is, but he certainly caught a fucking crocodile around
in
the body.
Florida or some shit?
Probably just grabbed it in a bear
hug vacation?
And picks it up. I don't know, but there's a video. See if you can bring up the president of Chechnya catches crocodile.
Jackson's gotten guys out of there. So.
Oh, yeah, a lot of tough guys.
Yeah.
And Fabrizio Verdum, there are pictures of him with the president of Chechnya at his dinner table.
Right.
And
I'll probably catch some shit for it.
Crocodile.
You might
Restless
catch
crocodile
some shit like
bizarre.
Your boy.
Well, here you go.
Like
well,
your
there
boy Penn did.
There's the president. That's your president. And he...
Did he?
Who
caught shit?
Penn. Freaking the actor. What's his name, Penn?
Sean?
Sean Penn with El Chapo.
Here's the president.
Oh, yeah. Same kind of thing.
This is so weird. They took a crocodile and put it... This is a fake.
Yeah, that's fake, bro. That's not even him.
Well... That thing's
no,
dead.
It's cut.
Yeah.
That thing is dead.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Let's not show that, Chin.
Why?
He didn't catch him.
Well,
the thing was dead.
It's obviously a fake
false setup.
It's obviously a fake setup. Really bizarre. He grabbed it by the snout with one hand. Interesting. Terrible cutaways.
I don't know the way you told the story. It was a bear wrestle.
Yeah.
No, bro, you see him. If you let it go, you see him pick it up.
You're 0-for-2 today with stories and.
No, you see him. You didn't let it fucking go. He grabs it around the body and picks it up.
You don't need to get vulgar with me, pal.
Hey,
sorry,
man.
Sorry. There it is.
Again.
Doesn't matter.
Well, the listeners won't be able to see it, and the video kind of sucks. Yeah. It's a fake crocodile.
It's yeah,
my point
video.
Is
so
that my point is it's
it.
A very bizarre and
the video's cut
thing.
Well, though. I got
to
tell you, hey,
yeah.
Nice job.
My point is that he
production
value is
pretty good.
Would you say
the production value is pretty good?
Yeah, like
so it seems as if it was
very bizarre. It's a very bizarre.
He grabbed it there. I think that's the whole video.
Man, yeah. Oh, man.
But that's the picture.
Oh.
I'd fight that crocodile. It's not that big.
Would you?
Yeah. We used to have those in the Bronx.
39 years old.
Is that all he is?
Yeah.
Boy.
Yeah. Trains.
What am I doing?
You're going to have a blast.
What am I doing?
I'm going to get killed.
You're going to have a
blast.
Would
you bring your son with you?
He's going to come with me.
Is he?
Yeah, when he's done with school.
Your son is more mature than you and I.
Yes.
He's 20 years old. When Frank and I, we get a little drunk, we're at his house, and we start doing inevitably something ridiculous, like, I don't know, wrestling or dry humping or something ridiculous. And your son literally just goes, oh, guys, seriously, you're going to knock over the table.
Get out of here.
And he just looks at me with this.
Dude, he's getting in shape. He's in the gym. Every time I'm there, he's usually obsessed. There. One of you two are there.
Yeah, he's obsessed.
Is he?
Yeah. It's funny because he was a little chubby kid, and I was always worried that he was going to be a little chubby kid his whole life.
I've seen his body change since.
I know.
I mean.
I know. He sprouted up.
4 years. I've seen him over the 4 years. Like today I saw him. Like, damn, bro, you're getting lean.
He's lean, yeah.
And he has your genetics. Your wife has good genetics.
Yeah,
too,
and
he's
obsessed with, you know, the food and all that stuff. And so it's good for him.
Yeah. He came in. He had a tattoo on his forearm. My gun went, hey, bro. You in a gang? You a gang member now? He's like, get on my dad. He's like, get off me. Like, don't let me catch you in a gang. Don't let me catch you in a gang.
Old Uncle Brendan.
Making sure he's not in a gang.
Manhandle you with his shovers. My manhandle you in a corner with his shovers.
Is he going to school here now?
He's got to make up a couple classes at Santa Monica, and then the plan is to go to UCLA starting in the fall.
And what's he want to do?
He's going to film school.
Oh, he wants to follow Papa's footsteps.
Yeah. I mean, not me. He's into the whole, he's on the other side. He really wants to, I think he's got a little bit of the acting thing, and he's like afraid to tell me.
Yeah, let's kill that. Let's kill that. Let's squash that.
No, see, I think it could be, because if he wants to be behind the scenes, it might be good to know what the actors go through.
You know what I said to him?
True.
If you have a curiosity about
do
something,
it.
Explore that curiosity.
Do it. The same thing when people ask me about fighting, I'm like, do it, man. You don't know what path it's going to lead you
no
to.
Idea.
You have no idea.
That's right.
So whenever anyone shits on your dreams, because they're scared to do it.
That's right.
Yeah,
it's like life's like a documentary. There's so many friends of mine that make documentaries. They start out and they're making a documentary about this glass. And along the way, they find out there's a sneaker there. Mm-hmm. The next thing you know, they've made a most incredible documentary, and it's all about that sneaker.
Yeah.
The glass was never mentioned again.
That's how life is.
That's exactly right, man. You got to get something that you can sink your teeth into, and then you know.
I think that's the best advice ever. Like, especially if it scares you. If it scares you, you should do it.
Absolutely.
Because it'll open up a completely different world for you. You'll meet better people.
Look at me at this age. Like, I love acting. I love the process of acting. I love now the process of putting the movies together and TV shows. I put this TV show together. We sold it to, you'll see, it's kind of impressive. And I kind of love that. But this whole thing with my show Kingdom and the fight, and just getting to know fighters at a different level and becoming friends with fighters, MMA guys and boxers, and then doing movies like The Purge and Captain America, people identify me with this certain type of...
Yeah.
And I never thought... I couldn't plan that. It's just kind of done. Yeah. It's just like...
Naturally,
it's just kind of organically. Yeah. Like the river changed its path, you know?
What did you think? When you first started getting into acting, what did you think was going to happen?
You know, I think every actor, like I was on a soap opera and I was making a fortune. I was a kid, you know, and I'm thinking, oh, this isn't serious. I want to be a serious actor. I don't know what the fuck that is.
Yeah.
I don't know what the fuck is serious.
Daniel Day-Lewis?
I guess. Is that a serious actor?
Yeah. He's not funny.
He's not. I guess that's a serious actor, right? And so... But is the acting you do any less serious? I don't
well,
I think
even when you're doing comedy, the point is not to let anybody smell a joke. Jackie Gleason was the great one because he was doing drama.
And by the way, Jackie Gleason, to me, I thought was a brilliant actor.
One of the best. Are you kidding?
But how many guys that do comedy always want to do serious acting? Yes. Like, look at Jim Carrey.
Oh.
Silly goose.
By the way, Adam
Sandler.
It's fine. And everybody should do everything that they want to.
Because I think that's the pinnacle, though, right? Like,
I guess.
Well, I think that people strive. Actors and people in general want to be authentic. And when you get into the business of acting, because usually you see a movie, it makes you feel that combination of great joy and great sadness, that thing called grace or glory, or you know, you can get so moved by a movie. Like when I saw Raging Bull, I was so moved by not only the experience but also what that person was able to do, where he gained all that weight. That was unheard of back in the day. So when I saw that motherfucker do that, and I was like, this movie's the greatest movie. I was like, who is that guy? I wanted to do that. When I saw the Russian roulette scene in Deer Hunter, I was so fucking overwhelmed with emotion that I wanted to be involved in that
somehow.
Yeah,
but when I saw Smokey and the Bandit, I wanted to be fucking Burt Reynolds.
Movie, great.
Yeah. I mean,
great
so,
movie. Another great actor, by the way, doesn't get his due.
But, you know, never, you know, I mean.
You want to talk about a great movie, Sharky's Machine. He was a great dramatic actor.
He's great, man. He was fun. I mean, you know, but I think actors want to be taken seriously or consider themselves serious actors because they like to see, listen, the people who get patted on the back, people whose name, the Meryl Streeps of the world, and the Robert De Niro's, you know, I want to be that. You know, yeah. I want to be Tom Brady.
You want to be taken seriously.
I want to be taken seriously yeah. by the people I do it with.
Don't you think that like you're always told that you got to love yourself or that, you know, you have to work through things and just believe in yourself. I actually think that sometimes confidence, this is going to sound really weird, but confidence and really liking yourself can be the enemy of an artist. Like, I think that you need to have a hole that you can never quite fill.
I think you need the confidence. Otherwise, I feel like casting directors, I think the crowd, they can smell blood in the water.
But fear for me works. Like when I feel off my
pins. Big difference between confidence and fear. Yeah. Completely two different
things. You're always
things.
Afraid. I mean, I'm always a little bit terrified. Afraid. That's just exciting. Yeah. But
even great big actors, like you've worked with really big actors.
And they're not.
Were nervous the first day of shooting. You were telling me about.
Yeah. And by the way, it's all happenstance because. I'll go with it. Like you'll fight anybody, right? Mm. You know what I mean? I can act with anybody, you know, I mean, me and Leeson went toe to toe for a whole movie, and it's not all of a sudden like he's great, right? I'm a huge like before I met him, I named my kid Liam after him, right? Yeah. But when we were doing it, I'm like, oh, there's no magic here. He did the work like I did the work.
Yeah, that's right.
Do you know what I mean?
That's right.
It's the same thing.
Yeah, that's right. But that comes also with experience and age. And
Yeah.
You know, in the beginning.
And listen, 10,000 hours, man. Yes. I don't care how many times. I was watching a documentary about the Beatles the other night, and we thought when the Beatles hit in America that they were just these four guys that got together the day before.
Are you kidding me?
They would play
6 hours.
Yeah. They'd go to Germany. They were in Germany. They would play clubs with one person all night long.
They were literally on stage for 6 hours a night. And every night. So Malcolm Gladwell in his book The Outliers looked at how many hours they were on stage playing other people's songs and their own songs. There is no one. There is no band that could come close to the number of hours they put in before they made it.
That's right.
I mean, they would go to Germany for real, and they were like, we'd get like beer, we'd get free beer and girls. And they would go and they would be on stage for it. Think about this. I'm telling you, 6 hours. That is so fucking
so long.
Because people would come in all night and they would have to play.
Right.
And they got so good, and then they started writing their own songs.
That's right. And prolific songwriters, by the way.
Oh my God.
Aside from Mozart, maybe.
Yes.
Nobody has Beatles, done
Duke Ellington too.
Yeah. Well, I think the all those things, like people see the finished product, but they don't see the grind and the hours. They just see that final product. Like, I'd love to be Conor McGregor.
Yeah.
I bet do you realize what he said? Sacrifice to get there.
That's right.
Do you realize?
That's right.
Man, I'd love to be The Rock. Every big athletic guy says that in Hollywood. Do you realize how talented and how hard he worked?
Yeah.
Like, do you realize how hard that dude worked to get there?
I know. Sometimes I think, like young actors say, you know, man, they hit a TV show or they get a movie and they're off to the races. I'm like, you're in trouble, man. You are in
I say the
trouble.
Same thing.
You have no stamina. You have no idea what you're in for. You're going to throw shit at you and you're not going to be prepared.
Yeah.
You have not done enough work. To carry
to
that.
To navigate the
absolutely
responsibility.
Absolutely not. And I feel bad. Like, I have friends, like Colin Farrell, great actor. Great actor. Great guy. Love him. At 20 years old, 21 years old, he did Tiger. They threw money at him. Like, he became the guy.
15 mil, yeah.
You can't possibly understand how to navigate through life. He doesn't have enough experience.
The same thing happens in athletics. You know, you get a kid who's a first-round draft pick, and everyone's expecting him to be, you know, Russell Wilson. It's like, fuck, he's an outlier, man. He's not ready to navigate this team.
No way.
He's really not ready to take all these vets and lead them to Super Bowl.
Men.
And the people get mad. It's like, fuck. Look at Aaron Rodgers. At least he had 4 or 5 years sitting on the bench to learn the ways of being a professional.
I didn't know that. I'm sorry that I don't know football, but Aaron Rodgers was on the bench for four
or
5 years.
Favre, yeah.
Oh, man. Wow. It's like, Steve Young on the 49ers.
Steve Young
sat behind Joe Montana forever.
But now everyone wants it. Russell Wilson, we want this.
By the way,
it's like, fuck,
that's the burden. That's the burden of millennials, of that whole thing.
Oh, they want it now.
Now. And they expect it. And they expect that they deserve it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a shift and in consciousness about who
I got a kick out of this conversation because this is how every 50-year-old has spoken since the dawning of time. We've all been like the younger generation.
No.
That's
no,
how we talk.
Yeah, I mean, I don't even say the younger generation. I just notice, you know, I mean, it's just, it's different.
Well, you know,
it's different enough because it happens faster, right? things happen faster. There's more outlets. There's Netflix. There's Hulu. There's Amazon. There's how many TV channels
it's
now?
It's everywhere.
And back when your dad, let's say he was an actor, how many TV stations were there? Maybe seven? If you don't have a show,
four.
You're kind of fucked.
Four. There were four.
You're kind of fucked. Now,
40 million people would watch one show.
Exactly.
Now, now I remember I did a TV show with Gary David Goldberg, who created Family Ties, right? We were between Friends and Frasier. It was me, Elizabeth Jesus Perkins, Bokeem Woodbine. It was called Battery Park. Friends and Frasier. I got off a plane from New York after the soap opera. Literally, I was here 9 days. I went and met with this guy. He gave me the job. I didn't no audition, nothing. I met with him. And UTA was like, what happened? And I was on the show. This is Spielberg's first television show. Uh-huh. Spielberg and Jeffrey Katzenberg.
Big deal.
They came to the taping every Friday night, right? Spielberg and Jeffrey Katzenberg went up, had the speech of a lifetime by NBC. Your life's going to change. You know, you're between Friends and Frasier.
Been there.
I mean, we were crazy. They were pumping us.
You're making a shopping list. Your whole life.
Making a shopping list. I bought a new Range Rover.
I remember the show so well. I remember talking to you about it.
We had a great time doing it, too. Gary David Goldberg, the king of comedy, right? So between Friends and Frasier, so we shoot our 10 episodes. I buy a house. Somehow I buy a house, and I buy a Range Rover, right? I've never done that before. And I'm thinking, I don't know. They told me I'm like, don't worry about it. The guy at NBC who sits in the big office said, I'm going to be like Joey on Friends. I'm the fucking next Joey. I'm going to sell this house. I'm going to get another house. Don't even worry about it, Mom. Right? So Friends and Frasier both got like 38 million viewers. Right?
Good Lord.
And we come out and we premiere to like 28 million. So it was 38 million, 28 million, 38 million.
Pretty good.
So we lost 10, but they got the 10 back.
People go to the bathroom, walk their dog, called though. The Golden Hammock.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Right? Okay.
It's between those two.
Well, How about this?
It's still good. Good, dude. 28 million. 28 million at the time? Okay, that was one-fifth of the fucking United States.
Not good enough.
28 million wasn't enough?
Not good enough. Uh-uh. By the way, I was right. I did sell the house, but not to get another one. It's because I couldn't afford that one anymore.
Bob, I remember you came up to me and you go like this. You go, so I had a meeting with my business manager. I go, what? He goes, I got to start selling stuff. I never forgot you said it.
I'm like, okay, all right. I guess this is.
What? So after 10 episodes, we're just not. See ya. The ratings aren't high enough.
They need to be in the 30 millions.
I did the same
thing. And it canceled.
Bro, now if your show does a one share in the demographic, which is maybe 6 million people, you're a hit.
Yeah.
A hit.
And back then, it's like, sorry, guys.
Oh, yeah.
It's over.
It's over.
Dude,
And then Gary Cole Cromie says, I'm going to do a show with you and Bokeem. We're going to do a spinoff. I love this idea. And then he got sick.
And died?
He didn't die, but then eventually, he passed away recently, a beautiful human being. One of the geniuses of the business.
Yeah.
And, he loved me because he was a street kid from Brooklyn. I was from the Bronx. Like, he loved, I was a regular guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
wanted to be around you.
Yeah, it was cool.
I did Inside Sports. Remember? I did Inside Sports. It was right between Will and Grace and Friends. Again, in the middle of the two hot shows.
Who was on that B?
Breckenmeyer.
And
an insanely talented Jen Irwin. And Miriam Shore.
The names that they're two such.
Those two women are the fucking most talented human beings I've ever worked with in my life. Again, journeyman. Both of those women are working, doing theater, this, that, the other thing, but incredible. But I remember we had a director who was directing the Friends thing, and he was saying, "You guys going to buy Porsches?" And next year because they'll give you probably a bonus of a Porsche. And I was like, "Huh?"
Yeah, they did that. They did that for the. For Will and Grace.
Yeah, I was shooting baskets with Deion Sanders and Michael Irvin. We're shooting baskets. I'm not good. And obviously, and we're talking, and I'm talking to this director, and I'm just like, dude, this is it. I've put my dues in. By the way, this was 14 years ago. I put my dues in. I've really worked hard, and this is when it happens. We did 13 episodes, and I gave away $35,000 to charity. I gave it away. I was like, I'm going to give this charity $35,000. Mm-hmm. Don't want to talk about it. And then we went away. I got a call. Got some not so good news, I heard, and we're not coming back.
That's why I love my show on DirecTV. Or no rating. There's no ratings. Netflix, there's no
ratings. Netflix, same thing. Yeah, we're talking to Jim Norton about it. A lot of people, they don't No ratings. Netflix don't release ratings.
No ratings. They just keep renewing my show. They just love that it's a quality show. So people love it. It's global. You know, they've sold it all over the world, and it's all they care about.
Yeah.
They need content.
Original content is the name of the game.
Now, you're a producer now, and you're making decisions on who is in your projects. You got a fighter and kid. We're going to get about 9 million downloads this month. I mean, we got to reach. And I'm just saying, if you want our audience to not watch your stuff, then don't put us in show. You want your audience to watch.
He's going to come with me.
What about?
Well, you sit in that red chair.
What the fuck, dude? What about?
Your wife said you can't travel, bro.
Okay, but let me and Brendan be in the raid. We want to be. What could we be?
What's the plot?
The Raid is a saw The Raid or The Raid 2? It's a famous Indonesian martial arts film. It basically takes place in a building where this group has to go in and take over the building from this group of drug dealers.
We can't be a drug dealer.
And by the way, the guy who's leading the team, his brother is the guy who's in there.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah. So Carnahan and I was attached to it a long time ago at Sony. It fell apart, and then Sony, after Joe and I created the company, Sony passed it back to XYZ, the producers who made the original, and they came to us and said, we want you to do it.
Weird. You look like a good drug dealer.
Also, I do a Sony show. I know Sony, so...
You
play a thug,
by the way,
drug dealer.
Sony is not involved. We got it back from them.
Right.
That wouldn't matter because Sony TV and Sony...
You know what I'm saying, though, dude?
No, I don't.
Hey, you get the correlation.
No, I see what you're trying to do.
I see what you're trying to do.
Watch me be a bad guy. I think The Raid is coming, and that guy with good hair must die. And then you go, and I watch. Zoltan, go and kill them.
And then am I like...
Your line is, yes, boss. Dude, I can't give you a lot of lines.
No, I need to be like a main guy.
No, say yes, boss.
I'm the big dude. I'm like Bane, and then you're on my back. Like I'm like
yeah.
I'm on your back.
And I release you. Like, yeah, my special weapon.
Okay, watch.
I'm like, get him, Gimp.
Okay,
and
hold
I release
on. But don't
you.
Call me Gimp. Call me
get him, fucking.
No,
Gimpy.
I want a name.
Release the Gimp.
I want a name like Han.
Release Gimp. No, the Gimp.
I want my name to be Han.
Hun. Okay,
so watch. Ready? Master, command me. Command me. I wish to kill.
See, that's good. Like
fucking creepy.
You're like a
Schmeagle. You're telling me I can't have a part?
Hey, you're like a Schmeagle on my back.
Master, let me go. Command me. I want to kill.
But you're like a monkey picking
you know
my
what it's too
like
close?
I picked
no,
the
No, I'm going to tell you what he's doing right now. He's doing, in 300, they had the
back.
And you're saying,
please, let me be part of the 300.
Yes,
okay, that's not bad, dude, but I'm not. I'm doing my
Leonidas.
Own.
Leonidas. I said, my father said, find Leonidas.
Dude, that's exactly what he's
Join doing. Leonidas.
That's a fucking
join Leonidas.
Dude, why are you not playing more characters?
Why are you not the reject?
I can lift my shield this much.
Dude, you're fucking
He's all, let me see you lift your shield. He's off.
Frank Grillo. Frank Grillo played a gimp.
Yeah. Pretty damn out convinced.
Dude.
His crooked face.
You're talking out the side of your mouth. Holy fuck.
Those are just noises I make.
All right, so how about this?
Too creepy.
No.
You lost us, bro.
Now you're ripping off. Ted, what's his name? In
Ted Danson.
Silence of the Lambs.
You're talking about Billy Bob?
Yeah, no, when he says, precious.
Oh, that guy.
Precious.
Okay, how about this?
Mesner, release.
No,
release
no, because you're gonna be small and like
that's now. A fucking scary voice, you guys.
Hey,
I'm in French.
Release moi.
See, that's kind of scary.
Hey, je fais le mort.
Talk in German. Hey, the way the dog trainer talked, that was scary.
Oh yeah,
Vas. How do you say down?
Plus. Blast.
This is what we're talking about, how it's so much cooler in German.
How about that dog?
Yeah.
How about that dog?
He was filling me in on how if somebody
breaks
into my house and the dog...
Liability. We got 1,000 emails of people like, do not get that dog. And guy sent me all these news clippings.
Really?
Oh. It's a great dog.
That's why I love our fans. Thank you, fans. You're right. It's a great dog.
It's liability.
It's liability.
I could tell you were nervous about that.
Yeah.
Even having that dog around, I'd have to shoot it. Eventually.
I love that dog. But
someone sent me a clip of this.
They fight too hard.
Someone sent me a clip of this. This family bought one of those trained German Shepherds. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying all of them are like this. This is an outlier, I guess. This is an exception. They bought one of those trained German Shepherds. They flew it in. bit this 4-year-old's leg so bad he had to amputate his leg.
No, I can't have that.
My friend, my buddy bought two of them. His house got robbed up in the Beverly Hills. Beautiful house. House gets robbed. He gets two trained German shepherds from Germany, pays like $30,000 each for them, has to talk to them in German. Mm-hmm. Now, like us, he drinks wine and came home one night and he's got to let the dogs out. And he notices one of the dogs is already out because the gate was left mm-hmm. open. And where's the dog? In his face.
I told the story on the podcast.
And he cannot remember German.
When he's drunk.
That's what I left
out. He doesn't know what to say to the dog. So
I don't want that dog.
He backs into his car. And now he's very wealthy, fortunately. He calls the guy and says, come get these dogs off my property.
Yep.
And had to eat the $60,000. And for a while, the cage sat there. And I would come to his house every once in a while and I would say, how the dog's doing?
That's a hell of a house, too.
Yeah,
it's a liability, man.
I've been to that house. That's a hell of a house. I remember you told me that when he has a party for the Hollywood people,
right.
That if somebody dropped a bomb on that area, there would be no Hollywood.
No anymore. More Hollywood.
Like that's how no more movies. It is. Like,
I mean, you walk.
Okay.
You know who he is, but we'd walk into like a Christmas party and just around one table, you'd be like, huh?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
It's almost like off-putting. It's like,
that many famous people.
Where do I go from here? You know what I mean?
You can feel pretty insignificant in some of those parts. Yo, you're an actor? Oh, yeah? Take a look at this. You know.
I don't know.
Let's do some current events.
Sure.
What's up, Chin?
What's going on?
Let's do some current events. The great Frank Grillo. Love that guy.
Dude, I see him every morning. I have a conversation with that guy every morning.
You do.
We're at the gym every one of the day at the same time.
It's amazing. Works out more than anybody I know.
He's a monster.
Yep.
What do you got, Chin?
All right. First current event is Jason Ellis fighting in King of the Cage in a pro MMA match.
He's had fights before. A lot of people don't know that. He fought Gabe Rudiker, who's on The Ultimate Fighter. He's fought in boxing. He does the Jason Ellis Manias thing in Vegas where he does all those crazy acts. He trains nonstop. I figured something like this was going to pop up because he was vying for a shot at CM Punk forever. Like, you talk shit to CM Punk nonstop.
Wow.
Going, let's fight. Let's fight in the UFC. At Dana White. At CM Punk. Wow. Bring it. I think you'd beat CM Punk.
Where does he train?
Somewhere in Hollywood. He trains a lot.
Yeah.
A lot.
Bet.
Of it. Yeah. Nonstop. I don't know shit about the guy he's fighting.
I saw his record. It's pretty...
What's his record?
Crazy. All losses.
Let's
literally
see if I can pull
losses.
It up here. So... That's his record.
Oh wow!
But these are all pro fights too, which is pretty crazy. How do you get past this many? And he has one win over here.
That noise was so funny.
What's his record? What's his record overall?
He won one out of his last 15. But his overall record is
I've seen some
14
salty records,
wins, 25 losses.
Hey, listen. You know Jason's not young. He's not a professional fighter. He's doing this. He's leaving his huge show and risking his following. You know, I condemn him, you know.
The guy's 5'5". He's fighting. 5'5". That's very
They say
short.
Jason's here is 135. I didn't know he's that small.
That is not true. No.
So how 200, everybody 200 and at least 10 pounds.
What? No, not 210.
6 foot.
No, he's probably 190 maybe.
Yeah, he's actually thin.
Maybe 180.
But he's got a big frame. I mean, he's...
God, I wouldn't say Jason's a big frame guy.
Really?
He's definitely not 135, though.
I double checked.
He might be 180, 190.
Because the last person he fought was this guy, Tony Giannopoulos. So it's the same Jason Ellis that fought this guy, but who knows what happened here with the record.
Yeah. But the guy's fighting, it says he's 5'5", which is...
I don't know if you can trust these things. It said Jason.
This is 170 on this guy.
5'5". Either way, it's cool for Jason. He hasn't done it forever. Maybe it's just, something to concentrate on. It's a goal. I support it, man. It's pretty cool. I mean, he's crazy. I wish he'd stop getting brain trauma, but... Jason's that, he's a risk taker, man. Yeah. And he'll have a big following. I'm assuming it'd be the biggest fight, was it King of the Cage?
King of the Cage,
in quite some time with Jason's following.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think he's actually doing a race car race that morning and fighting at night.
I love it.
He's crazy.
What a badass. Jesus Christ.
He's crazy.
I mean, to people like, hey, Brian, you got a lot of testosterone. No, I don't. No, I don't. There are a lot of examples of people that are way fucking...
He might have the craziest life we know because...
Jesus.
He does his radio shows.
I play tennis.
He has a book, right? He has like multiple books out. He has a serious show.
And a wolf tattoo on his head. He has a wolf tattoo on his head.
He does Jason or Ellis Mania all the time, right? That crazy shit. Then he's skateboarding, and then he does MMA training, boxing, jiu-jitsu, wrestling nonstop. And then you'll catch him. Hey, man, depends what mood he's in. He might fuck your girl. He might suck your dick.
Yeah, no, he's an amazing man. He's the most.
He'll drink blood.
He's the most well-rounded person on the planet. He'll get freaky. He'll get saint-like. He's a sinner. He's a saint.
I got his back, though. I love that guy.
He's everything. He's everything.
And I love that guy.
Well, he's you wouldn't want to. He makes the world way more colorful.
That's a good way to describe Jason Ellis. He's colorful flower.
And I believe he was even thinking about doing a little stand-up, from what I understand.
I think he did try stand-up.
There you go. There you go. So God bless the man who's he's basically
he's a Swiss Army.
He's basically fearless. He's basically a fearless
Fear
man.
Fear is not a factor for you,
no.
sir.
Oh, you want to fight me? You're Shane Carwin, no problem. That's a cock? All right, no problem either.
I'll swallow a thing whole.
There's a whole
Carwin, you hit like a Mack truck, bring it.
Bring it. Yeah. He's incredible.
What else you got?
More, way more man than I'll ever be.
The next one is Dave Chappelle. You know that show Key and Peele?
Oh, yeah. One of my favorite shows.
Dave Chappelle did an interview with Gayle King, and he was mentioning how his feelings were hurt because he feels as though they took his concept but didn't thank him.
Well, what he said was, yeah, and this is really weird because he said that essentially he was the one who came up with the format.
Yeah.
And when
a sketch comedy?
And yeah,
a duo sketch.
I got
comedy?
A lot of thoughts on this. And then on top of that, when he saw that it was created by Key and Peele, he said that hurt my feelings. Well, do you want them to say it was created by Dave Chappelle because you had the Chappelle show? No, no, I don't agree. You know, again, we want to go back to Monty Python. You want to go back to all the shows like Saturday Night Live. This is not. It's not like the Chappelle show reinvented the wheel. It had a really great take on
some
sketch,
great sketches,
and it was really good. But you
but
can't
still classify as sketch
Key and
comedy.
Peele,
right?
Deserves their due, and they don't have to say created by Dave Chappelle. It was created by Key and Peele. It was solely their effort, the years, the hours that it took to get to be that good. They deserve the credit, and they don't have to give Dave Chappelle any credit. They can say Dave Chappelle was our influence, or maybe was an inspiration. As every artist has inspiration. But, I mean, I don't even know what you're talking about here. It's a very strange thing to say. It really is. I disagree. I just disagree, man.
He says, so when I watch Key and Peele and I see they're doing a format that I created, and at the end of the show it says created by Key and Peele, that hurts my feelings.
Put some respect on my name. Y'all don't know what I've been through watching Key and Peele do the show the last 5 fucking years. Huh. All right. Well, I disagree with you. And you don't need any respect on your name. A lot of people have
Dave
respect
Chappelle.
On your name. You're Dave Chappelle.
So, you know, last night at midnight, he dropped 2 comedy specials on Netflix.
Mm-mm. Yeah, he's
back
doing
to
fine.
Back. Dropped 2 of them.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think there's no reason for him to pick on Key and Peele. Like, shouldn't you celebrate
other
African Americans
or
in
just
sketch
other
comedy?
Comedians,
didn't
other
they
comedians.
Win an Academy Award for it?
Look, Jordan Peele.
I think they won an Emmy. Or not Academy. They won an Emmy, I think.
Jordan Peele just the first. Was it Peele or was it Key? Basically, it was Peele, I think, who was the first African-American to break $100 million with a movie that he wrote and directed.
The scary
yeah,
movie,
a little
yeah.
respect. A little respect on that name.
Get Out or something.
And there's enough respect to go around everywhere. And, I'm a comedian, and I have very little... I'm not afraid of any comedian in the world, and I'm not. I very little. The comedy gets very clicky, and it gets very reverential sometimes about certain sacred cows. Maybe because I'm 50 and I'm a comedian, and I think I'm pretty good. I just don't believe in any of that, and I hate competition.
Is there any
I hate
need for that,
competition? I don't think so. For me, I don't think there's any.
Like Dave Chappelle's killing it.
Celebrate
two
these motherfuckers.
Netflix specials yeah. dropping, and then.
Celebrate these guys. Nobody has to put any respect.
But
on
also,
name.
The only reason why they had an opportunity was also because you went on hiatus. You left, which gave them an opportunity for a sketch show.
Correct. I think you know. Look, everybody. Who knows what he really meant? Maybe he was having a moment. I don't know Dave Chappelle, and so I don't want to say. I don't want to.
He gave
get
them
into what
props too. He says he's a fan of the show. It's
yeah,
just,
that's fine.
He just feels as though. Like
I know
that was
man.
His thing.
But just because it's on Comedy Central and it's sketch comedy, so does everyone who's ever had a show on Comedy Central got to say created by Dave Chappelle?
Yeah. And does he have to put created by Dave Chappelle?
Because then in Living Color, whoever created in Living Color shit, it's then created by the guy who created in Living Color.
I would imagine. I mean, if we all have to give created by to the all of us are influenced and
start?
To a degree mimic
start,
our
then?
Heroes. Yeah, correct. I find it very bizarre. Yeah. But it's not the first bizarre thing that Dave Chappelle, he's a creative guy who is entitled to being bizarre sometimes.
Fair point.
It's all good.
What else you got, Chin?
Cool. Next one is Sesame Street. They're going to have their first Muppet with autism in the next few weeks, I believe.
Interesting. I always wonder with these things, is this more for the parents or for the kids?
Like, I think these are for the kids, to be honest.
No, what I'm saying is that is an autistic kid, and autism, by the way, a huge umbrella term, is the autistic kid going to feel better about himself and about life if there's a representative, a puppet representative?
Hey, man. It says this show has expanded their mission ever since, everything from ABC's 1-2-3s to race, even death. Hey, wow. I don't want my kid learning fucking death from Oscar the Grouch. Yeah. I don't want the Cookie Monster dropping knowledge of the way death works.
Yeah, I just think the whole thing, the United States is so in love with inclusivity. We've just got to be so inclusive and so politically correct. And
do you think there'll be a transgender Sesame Street?
Of course there will. You know, as you get to know things, there's a woman who wrote a book called Between Sexes, and she is actually what they call intersex. So she has a female biology, but she also has, the way she put it, she's genitally complex or genitally bi. So she probably has
set of balls,
something like a penis, you know, yet she has the biology of a woman. So you can have these things, both. Right? You can have something where there's you're intersex. So women, the more you learn about life, it's interesting. So what would you do about a woman? So a lot of women, there are women who are biologically women on the outside, but internally they have internal testes. They create more androgens. They have more testosterone. So they have more male, and they have an XY chromosome. So now think about this. So, and we have some people in the Olympics like this. They have a distinct advantage in their body shape, in their muscle tone. For sure. What do you do with that? The more you learn about shit, it gets crazier and crazier. Do we have to include everybody? It's nice to include everybody. I don't want to make anybody feel bad, but gee whiz, so I promise you're going to have a transgender.
That lady had like some form of a penis, but then also has a vagina?
She didn't. It's all in the book, and she didn't want to go into it in detail on NPR.
It's like our creator, God, whoever you believe in, was like, going to make eggs over easy, and sure. It was like fucked up, just made them scramble. You ever done that?
Something,
you
know,
like,
happens.
It's like, it's just this weird kind of
genetic. There are genetic like, cross-pollination.
Mix-ups, man.
Yeah, genetic cross-pollination.
And that's going to happen out of how many? 6 billion people? Like, there's going to be some.
Yeah, and typically what doctors
many in the world are there?
Well, doctors typically, if there is visible signs of that, a lot of times doctors will have the parents choose, right? So if the child's born a hermaphrodite, right? So a hermaphrodite being both sexes, the doctor will come to the parents and say, which do you choose? Or
the problem
recommend.
Is the wiring. You can't choose the wiring. Right. So if you say, a little boy, and then she's wired as a girl, yes. You fucked up.
That's kid's gonna leave it for a while, right?
Yeah. Oh, I guess.
Yeah.
But with Sesame Street, I guess autism, because if a kid has autism, can kind of relate to it. But where do we stop that? Is there going to be a Down syndrome?
Yeah.
Sesame Street baby?
Probably.
Or like, do we open it to everyone?
Well, transsexual, I don't know.
Like, is Ernie and Bert going to be freaking, I don't know.
It's a lot
They go through transformation. If you have to pick once, Ernie and Bert, you know they're the first gay Muppets.
They sure are. It's a lot of, and I never knew that until I talked to you about it or realized it, but there's a lot of, I guess, as we learn more about our biology and about, you know, sort of...
Complicated.
Yeah, I guess you're going to have... you know what I think? I'm going to be a little cynical, and I'm not usually so cynical. I think that the good people at Sesame Street, and I'm sure they're all good people, realize that there is a giant portion of our population, parents who have autistic children.
Yeah, and they can't relate.
And they
to
go,
anything.
this is a real opportunity to get more viewers.
I still don't have a problem with it either.
No, I don't.
Like,
either.
If you're a kid with autism, like, fuck, man. Like, none of my heroes have, no one in the comic books has autism. None of these athletes have autism. And then when you're a kid and you see one of your kids on Sesame Street, it also prevents less bullying when they go to school. Because, like, fucking Grover from Sesame Street had autism. You have autism.
Yeah.
I'm at least familiar with
it.
Like, I don't get to school. I'm like, what the fuck are you doing?
Well, when I was a kid, I remember my uncle, there was a kid who was just different. And I was like, I said to my uncle, I go, I was in Wisconsin in the North Woods, and I go, that guy's what I'm keep talking to him. He doesn't know how to do anything. He's not throwing a ball. He's like, you know. And my uncle said, hey, he's just slow. He's just a little slower than you are. That's all. And he explained it in those terms. He was mentally handicapped, right? He had Down syndrome. And I,
what
and
exactly, how's autism affect?
So autism is an umbrella term. So autism can be Asperger's syndrome. It's a spectrum. Autism can be a lot of things. Autism can be some children, like my friend's child, won't look you in the eye. And tends terrible. To have to touch everything. So even obsessive compulsive disorder. So David Sedaris, who would had to lick every doorknob on the way from school, had to count every square in the pavement. And if he didn't, he had to go all the way back and recount it. Talk Pretty Someday is one of the best
Books. Like Rain Man.
Correct.
Autism?
That is autism. That's a form
to
of autism.
To an extreme extent?
That would be extreme, because what happens is their brains are not as developed in one area, but they can be hyper-developed in another area.
But they're still functioning members of society.
They're functioning to the extent that they can, you know... they can tell you how to get to the moon, but they might not be able to tell you how to get to the store.
And forgive me for those that have kids or someone with autism, do they have to have caretakers?
Sometimes. 24/7? So Nabokov, who wrote the great book Lolita, which is a fucking brilliant book, but also very controversial still today, because it's about a pedophile. It's about a guy who's in love with a 12-year-old girl and who he calls a nymphette. And Nabokov pulls off, they made two movies about it. It's fucking brilliant. But he has Asperger's syndrome. And then he wrote another book. And Robert Evans, in his book, The Kid Stays in the Picture, was they wanted to make another movie, a hit movie. And he was reading the book. He read it three times, couldn't make sense of it. It's like, this movie makes no fucking sense. What the fuck is going on? He missed one. He just had Asperger's and wrote some crazy, you know. So you don't, it's hard to predict. Mm-hmm. It's hard to control. I guess the best way to say it is maybe with autism, one aspect would be that the kids don't have control over their own personality. I think that there's something a little bit miswired. Mm. I don't know how else to say it. I don't have as much experience, but I have friends who have autistic children.
What it's else you got, Chin?
Do you know if there's even any like different nationalities on Muppets? I'm trying to think if there's an Asian Muppet, but I don't think there is. Is there?
Well, there's an Asian Muppet.
Do
there's
they make the eyes small or anything like that?
They make them slitty.
No, but then they had the operation.
Yeah, there's an Asian.
They went to Korea and had
an
the
Asian
operation.
Muppet. There's Black Muppet. He's like a chef. Yeah, there's Black Muppets.
Asian Muppet's a chef?
I'm pretty sure he's a chef. I watch it with my kid on HBO.
Sesame Street's always been pretty great at.
Right on.
There are a lot of things to be mad at, and Sesame Street ain't one of it. You know.
Cool. And speaking of surgery, we were talking about this yesterday, but this girl,
she's pretty too.
She died after going through that butt lift that you guys are talking about.
Butt lift surgery.
And she left behind a 1-year-old kid. And apparently the same clinic last year, and this girl's only 25 years old.
She's so
pretty healthy, right?
I know. She's pretty, man.
A year ago, someone 29 years old died of the same surgery, same clinic.
What fuck. Happened? Probably stopped going to that clinic.
Yeah, they just didn't wake up.
It's one of the most dangerous surgery you can do, too.
Really?
Yeah, the How butt come? Lift. I guess but you're always sitting on your ass and out the bacteria, too.
Oh.
And then as long as you have to be under anesthesia, super dangerous.
She died about an hour later. At the hospital. I wonder what would that be, though?
I think it is through the anesthesia. Her heart.
Oh, no, here it is. Right? The fat particles likely entered the bloodstream through a vein during a fat transfer procedure in which liposuction is performed on the torso and the fat is injected to the buttocks.
Damn.
So they take the fat usually from somewhere and inject it straight into your ass. Sometimes it stains your ass and the loose fat can get into the bloodstream and kill you.
Fucking hell.
The last thing was she just stopped breathing.
Fuck.
So you can, I didn't know this. I thought, so you can actually put fat into your ass.
A lot of girls do. Instead of getting like implants, a ton of girls take fat, and you can see because right above their cheeks, like right here,
yeah,
you'll see two little marks.
Really?
Like the David Letterman of vampire just went.
No way.
Yeah. Like got a gap in his teeth.
Why is it the David Letterman?
Because he has a gap in his teeth. Like it's a.
Dude, that is the weirdest
analogy.
It's very interesting.
It's
all
weird,
right.
But you know what I'm saying? Like he had a gap in his teeth. So it's a David Letterman vampire bit their butt cheeks. So you can see two dots that are spread out.
Wow.
And that's from them injecting fat into the ass instead of ass like lifts.
Now I wonder what it feels like. Probably like an ass. Uh huh. Uh huh.
If done right, not mad at it. Yeah, I don't know how it works exactly.
You had your hand on a...
on a fakie?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've felt some fakies in my lifetime.
And you were very happy, pleased with the
outcome. Didn't even know. I thought, weird. What kind of mosquito bites around the ass in two spots?
Huh.
Another young lady when I was single, I thought, weird, this ass mosquito's everywhere.
Uh-huh.
These L.A. ass mosquitoes are really doing work.
I guess so.
Strange.
Instead of taking blood out, they put fat in.
Mm-hmm. Not mad at them.
All right. I like it because, you know, the human body, I guess, stores fat in different parts of the body. So some people store fat in their ass, some people in their belly. Some people put fat, like, uniformly on, like, their whole body.
They just goes, whoop.
Yeah, those people can put on 20 pounds. You don't really notice it because it's all over the body, yep. Which I got no problem with. And then some girls will put it just, I love girls like this. When I get fat, I put it in my boobs and my butt. I hate it. Well, I don't. Let's go ahead and get you a fucking pie.
Girl, let's get you a full rack of ribs and a slice of fucking apple pie.
Let's up those carbs.
Why don't you wash this down with a smooth Coca-Cola? Mm-hmm.
Let me go buy you two loaves of Wonder Bread immediately.
Mm-hmm. Lather it up with some butter.
Yeah, let's get that ass in those tits as big as possible. Yeah. I don't like it. It's vulgar. It might be vulgar to you. It gives me a huge boner.
Yeah, because I'm trying to glaze them buns.
That's right. Round, smooth surfaces, your tits and ass work.
Matter of fact, before you even finish this conversation, I got Postmates dropping off Taco Bell for your fat
She's
ass.
So skinny. She's totally skinny, but she's got these really big boobs and a really big butt. It's like, it's just weird to look
at.
It's
sick.
Is it weird to look at? What's her number? Where exactly does she live, please?
It's sick. Yeah. Is it sick?
That's disgusting. Well, yeah. Oh, does she wear eyeliner and fake nails as well? Oh, she's a stripper too? Oh, God. How vulgar. What's her name again? Where she live?
I'm sorry. Where she live?
Yeah. If I could.
Where does she perform at?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh, is she damaged too? Oh, yeah, daddy issues? Really? Daddy issues? Sounds good.
Is she on Instagram?
Yeah. Is there anywhere I can jerk off immediately? Because the pressure is really...
Do you know our Instagram so I can jerk this rock hard boner I have after you tell me all
arched feet, huh? Really smells like candy? Fantastic. Yeah.
Oh,
candy.
Weird.
Can't bring her around the parents?
She's Little Caesar's crazy, Brent. Just gets big tits and an ass.
Wouldn't want to bring her home?
Is she single? I'll marry her now.
Forget the home. I'll just get a motel room. Love polyester sheets. Yeah.
What else you got, Jim?
Sorry, guys. Sorry.
That's a bummer about that lady, though.
Sure is.
Indeed. This one, I was wondering if you knew much about this.
Kid looks
this,
good. This
Tim Tebow going to a low A Columbia.
Yeah, I like how they Tebow signed a low A.
What is that?
It's just single A. There's single A, double A, triple A.
Okay.
Triple A is the best.
Triple A is the best.
Before you go to majors.
So, if you're on a team like this, you're pretty fucking good at baseball. So he's on the single A feeder club for the New York Mets.
Wow. Listen, man. And he, you know.
So wording then, low A.
He's only 29.
It just gets headlines.
Yeah.
Give him a couple years.
Cool. I got some bad one here. A girl was raped on Facebook Live.
Gang
raped. There was 40 different people watching. No one said a word.
Jesus Christ. Hey, guys. 15-year-old
girl.
Hold on. To the police.
40 people were watching. Jesus Christ. I'm like,
you know how that you can show an audience.
Oh,
well,
wow.
Well, this one joined.
Jesus
this one joined.
Christ.
So these guys were raping this girl and go, hey, check this out. We're going on Facebook Live and raping
this
girl.
Live, yeah.
She was 15.
Fuck?
She was 15. Yeah.
She didn't die though, huh?
No. I don't know why they put
those 40 people that did nothing should have some sort of repercussion.
Facebook? It's just like that woman, what was her, Kitty Genovese, who was murdered and literally something like 100 people heard her screaming for help for an hour and the guy came back and killed her and it's the famous Genovese case. I mean, do something. When you see some shit, do it. Make a call. Get involved. Stop it. You know? I don't know.
That's terrible, man.
It's common. It's weird when groups... It's why children drown in crowded swimming pools all the time. People, it's at a pool party, a kid drowns.
Oh,
because everybody
fuck,
thinks
man.
That somebody's watching.
Look at this. It's the second time in months that the department has investigated an apparent attack that was streamed live on Facebook.
Yeah.
In January, 4 people were arrested after a cell phone footage showed them allegedly taunting and beating a mentally disabled
man. Yeah, that's those black girls and guys who had that white kid who was mentally disabled, and they were going, fuck Trump. Yeah, I'm putting the shit on my nobody's really liking my shit or whatever.
We talked about it.
But these are people. These are just like the lowest dregs of society. Scumbags like this. It's like, you know, and now they have a platform.
When you said that they should be prosecuted or whatever, have you guys done Facebook Live before?
No.
So I think I did it one time, and when you log on, it shows your name, the person that came on. You know what I mean? So
you can't prosecute somebody for not for because you don't know what they were looking at. Like, you don't know if they were like, is this a porno? Oh, yeah. What the fuck? You don't know. You don't know. Is this who? I don't. You know. Where is it coming from? Do you call the local police? You know. Yeah, this shit is all.
Does it have a location on there?
They've already arrested four people.
It just shows your name. Like,
they've arrested four fuckers in this.
Whatever your profile name is, whatever. That's fucking terrible. Show that this
Chicago, by the way, Chicago, you know, where people are just getting shot on street corners constantly.
Oh, yeah.
Is that it, Chin?
That's it.
Jesus, good ones.
Yeah.
You got a drop of knowledge, B?
I got a drop of knowledge. So here's my drop of knowledge I thought was interesting. Barack Obama approved how many drone strikes in his tenure?
A bunch, right?
Yeah, what would you say?
Give me...
It's hard to say. Yeah. 542 drone strikes.
You get more.
Yeah. Of how many people? This is in non-battlefield areas, okay, where American forces were not directly engaged, including Pakistan, Yemen, and Somalia.
So like targets?
Yeah. So non-battlefield areas. So not like, yeah, exactly. So in
like
cities.
There's a high-risk target in
yes,
there.
Yes, yeah. You know, high-value target.
Yeah, an ISIS member might be hiding out there. Can't get them.
Correct.
So they blow up the fucking building.
Yeah, so how many people do you think we've killed in the past since that? Since
out of those 500?
Yeah, 542 strikes.
5,000.
3,797.
Not bad.
Not bad at all. What I think is very interesting about that is that the United States keeps such specific numbers. Whenever you for the most part, and Radiolab did a really interesting thing on this, when you okay a drone strike, it actually has to go through legal counsel. The White House has a legal counsel, so a number of lawyers that will have to look at the legality of ordering the strike.
The way the
it's kind
pros
of fascinating.
And cons.
Yeah. And whether or not it's legal, whether or not you're able to kill, you know, when Obama launched the attack on Alawi, who was a American who was preaching in, I believe at the time, Yemen, killed a 16-year-old son and him. Later on, intelligence came out that this guy was directly involved in killing Americans and et cetera, et cetera. But it was very controversial. It had to go through a lot of legal hurdles. I think that's a very good thing before we can kill somebody, the United States has to go through lots of civilian oversight. And can't forget that.
Did you see today that they're doing a ban on like laptops, certain things out of those countries that like
majority Muslim,
Syria, like, you know, the same yes. where we're banning their refugees,
Syria, Somalia.
So there's a ban on from their airport flying anywhere, especially here, that they can't use laptops, iPads. They have to check them in, mm-hmm. and this is all I needed. I'm like, God, that kind of sucks. They can't have laptops on a flight. Like, no, because of our intelligence, they know that that's the next big move, that they're going to use those to create conflict. Right. So once I heard that, like, with our intelligence, we don't want to get in details, we can't have that on planes. I'm good. Fuck it. I'm good. I won't bring mine if it's, you know, I'm good with that.
That's going to be challenged in court. All these things are being challenged. It's very tough because Trump got himself in trouble when he called for the entire Muslim ban. And
different
they're
though.
Use
different
that.
Though. Same, yeah. same like, you know how you have to check your shoes, how you can't have certain things on the plane anymore? Mm-hmm. That's pretty easy to deal with.
My worry is that every time we impose a restriction on ourselves, the terrorists are winning. And listen, it's a very complicated thing. And as technology becomes more available to bad players.
Are the terrorists winning? When's the last terrorist attack on a plane?
I mean, and terrorists could be winning in a different way.
As far as restricting our travel?
Restricting the way we live our lives.
Kind of. So you have to wait 10 minutes at the airport.
No, it's more than that. It's giving government agencies like the CIA and stuff more authority to spy on us. And that has always led to tyranny historically, which is why, without going into it, the Founding Fathers warned us about that.
You mean spying on us as far as...
You want to make sure that you don't
but
give
what do you
any
do,
government...
B? I get that, but what do you... So we find out that the terrorists... That we there was a shoe bomber. He almost pulled it off, would have blown up that plane. So we know they want to do it. So, listen, we don't want... don't worry about your shoes. Just that it's a rare
occasion. That's, again, you're right. I mean, this is a very sticky, troubling problem because
it's kind of not.
Do you keep us safe?
Not that sticky. Like the thing with laptops, if our intelligence goes, we know they're building these laptops where they can detonate them on the plane. Let's just not deal with this. Let's force them to check these in. Because I don't think they're just pulling it out of ass code. Okay, no hats either on the plane.
No, I mean there are certain things we are going to have to deal with and contend with, like that maybe, where if this seems like a clear and present danger to the security of the American people,
which is
and
what
the
our
States,
central intelligence.
If that's the case, then there are unfortunately going to have to be certain measures.
You have to. You can't be the wild west.
You need
in
to
the
make
air.
Sure though that there that all other options are being exercised and on the table and there's transparency. I don't know.
It's same with flu. It's like can't over 8 ounces. Yeah. Cool, man. Don't fly with over 8 fucking ounces. Because we know they were going to try and blow up a plane with over 8 ounces. Mm-hmm. It's not the end of the world. Mm-hmm. Check your shit in or just don't fly with over 8 ounces.
Yeah.
Cool. That's,
when the intelligence agencies
they're doing
have
it for a reason.
Things, yeah, you got to listen to these guys who are trying to keep you safe.
Yeah, they're not making this shit up.
The other thing is that there's all this like, you hear a lot of people saying the CIA controls this and that. The CIA is also responsible for keeping us. The intelligence agencies in our country are there to keep us also safe. When the shit hits the fan, you're gonna want to feel safe. And the fact of the matter is that's what law enforcement is there for. It's just that we all know that government agencies should have watchdogs, should not grow too large, because like all agencies, like all entities, they're going to want to have more power over you than you want over them. Who governs the governor? Central question of political philosophy. Who governs the governor? The people should always govern. For the people, by the people, of the people.
Boom, boom.
That's very important. Anyway.
Very
quickly, guys. Very quickly, our boy Ryan in San Francisco, great guy and part of the Tariq Azim, Yusuf Azim clan. I want to give them a shout out because
owns S.
Yeah, the San Francisco Mint, 88 Fifth Street, on May 4th, they are having a big gala for a great charity called Project Reckless, and they basically target youth in the community that are most likely to drop out of school for a substance abuse, engage in criminal activity. There, a lot of these kids, the police department gives Project Reckless these kids and say this is their last chance. And what Project Reckless does is that it's a 7-month program where they rebuild hot rods and they auction them off, and all that money goes back into the program. But these kids learn everything from how to take care of a car, rebuild a car. Not only that, they also learn how to market the car. Yeah. So they learn marketing. They learn a whole subset of skills. And Ryan, that dude, if he's involved, I can promise you, it's going to be
good
a
dude.
Badass. Yeah, and he's very effective. Those guys are great.
He's
so they're giving back to the
kid.
Community. Project Reckless, May 4th, the Mint in San Francisco. Do a good deed. Show up. It's for a great cause. These kids need your help. And it's projectreckless.org.
And here's another kid that needs your help. Washington, D.C., Philadelphia. Brendan, the kid Callen needs your help.
And so does Brendan Big Brown Shop, because we're going to be there, Brendan. We're going to be there doing some shit, aren't we?
Mm-hmm.
And before that, if you want to see some comedy down in San Diego, March 30th, 31st, and April 1st, I'm bringing some heat. I'm going to be doing some comedy after I shoot my spinoff. So American Comedy Company, get your tickets at AmericanComedyCo.com.
And we're at Philly and D.C. That is April 7th and 8th.
April 7th and 8th, buddy. I'm really excited about that.
7th Philly, the 8th is D.C. 930 Club. Both those bitches almost sold out.
Yeah. Love me some Philly. Love me some D.C.
Philly 7th, Washington, D.C. 8th. Get everything you need at TFATK.com. Next week, we drop Steak and Suck Tees and Skeptical Hippo. TFATK.com for everything you need. This is The Finally Kid. We're out.